Got your Bibles, turn to 1 Peter 1 and verse 2. Aren't you glad that we're getting some reprieve from all this bad news and this coronavirus? And I'm glad to see that people are being healed and people are beginning to show up on television. People are beginning to tell the story that they made it through this thing. And so I'm excited about that and encourages my heart. And so we've been praying for that. And so we're just going to believe that God's going to continue to heal our land. Amen? He says if his people would just humble themselves and come to him and humble down and pray, that he would heal our land. And I think he's doing it. And so I'm so glad about that. We'll take offerings. I know we typically take offerings during service, and this doesn't work that well, but at the end of service, what we'll do is take offerings as you go out. If you have something, you can drop it in there. You can use any of our electronic ways of giving as well. And so there's a new one that if you text to 94000, you can type, "I'm here, I am here," and that will make you check off in the system that you're here today. So if you just type the words, "I am here," to 94000, then that will tell us that you're here today and help us keep count. And then if you can also, you can type in "give today" and text that to 94000, and it gives you a place to give there as well. Amen. So we're over in Peter and 1 Peter, and we're going to be in chapter 1. And I won't keep you a long time. I appreciate all the work of our media folks and everything that they're doing, but they called me in for a meeting this week, and they told me, "You need to preach shorter." They said people don't listen to you when you talk over 10 minutes. Do you believe them? Well, that's why Dave had to get his head shaved, because when I got finished with him, there wasn't much hair left. So, no, I appreciate our sound people, and I appreciate all the work our worship team is doing. I appreciate all you being faithful today. But over here, let's go look at what Peter has got to say in 1 Peter to us. You know, we know this was written to the Jewish Christians driven out of Jerusalem and scattered throughout Asia Minor. And so here in verse 2, it says to us, "According to the foreknowledge of God the Father, by the sanctifying work of the Spirit, to obey Jesus Christ and be sprinkled with his blood, may grace and peace be yours in the fullest measure. Father, we love you and we thank you for your word today, God. And I pray, Father, that you will use me as a messenger somehow, Lord, to communicate the message that you have for us today. God, may it be fresh and be live in our hearts as we receive what you have for us today. God, I titled the message that you are chosen. And Father, I believe that every single one of us have been chosen by you. And Father, I appreciate so much your love and direction in our life. Please use this preacher now to bring forth the word of God, that it might bring glory to you. In Jesus' name, amen." Amen. There's a, I read to you from the New Standard Version, which I typically liked very, very well, and it's actually what I use most of the time. I love the King James Version of the Bible. The these and thous are sometimes difficult for people, and so the New Standard Version, English Version, has that, the these and thous removed in this context, and all the meaning is still the same. But I wanted to read something to you this morning, just from a different version, the same scripture, but it's just written in a different language that causes us to think about it differently. You were chosen according to the purpose of God the Father, and were made a holy people by His Spirit. Same words that's over here in this version, it's just more clearly for us to understand. So when it talks about according to the foreknowledge of God and the sanctifying work, He picked us, He chose us. God chose us to sanctify us and make us new. And so that's what we're talking about this morning. There are many people in the world that are asking themselves, especially today, they're saying, what is my life? What is wrong with me? What is going on in my life that something could be, am I not doing things right that's causing things to happen? They don't know that there is a hope for them. And in our world, as a Christian, hope is really essential for us. We must have hope. If we don't have that hope, then there really isn't anything for us to continue on about, because we need the hope of Jesus Christ in our life. He is our sustaining power. And so we get over here and we see what Peter is telling us. We know that Peter the Apostle wrote this letter to encourage believers who would likely face trials and persecution under the Emperor Nero. That same persecution happens to us in our world today. And so I believe Peter's words are just as important for us today as they were then. We look at verse 1, and the letter is addressed to aliens, or to the Jewish Christians scattered throughout the world, that is a result of the persecution against the believers. And so it wasn't little green men it was writing about, but it was writing about those who have been scattered about, who have once were in the same place, and now they are scattered in different places. And Peter is writing to them to say, hey, this meaning is for all of you. So I think it was clear in Peter's mind that he was talking to us as well. We've been scattered about. We all have our own jobs. We do different things. And I think that Peter was speaking to us that day. And he's saying that you and I need a genuine hope, not just an optimism about life. I meet a lot of people sometimes that tell me they don't need Jesus because they're generally optimistic person, meaning that they're happy and they choose to see things in a bright light and not a dim light. And I love that. I think it's wonderful. I do think the way we see each thing in our life is really how deeply and how encouraging God has been in our heart and how we personally take to choose to look at it. All of us will have struggles and trials. Some of us will face those with great zeal and exuberance and go right at it. I have a friend of mine diagnosed with cancer, and if you met her, you'd never hear about cancer. You would never hear that her body has been plagued with cancer for the last 9 years. You would never hear that from her, because it's not that she's choosing to deny it. She's choosing to not allow it to have power over her life. Because Jesus Christ is her hope, she only concentrates on those things that are positive and that give Jesus glory. So she's determined in her life that she is going to serve Him no matter what happens. And guess what? The doctors say, we don't know why this is happening to you, but every tumor that you have keeps shrinking. And you've never had one bit of chemo, you're not taking any treatments, and the tumors keep shrinking. You know why? I think that there's a way that you can praise yourself out of anything on earth that is going on in your life. I think you can lift up the name of Jesus, and He will give you the power to overcome. It's only when you let yourself get to a place that you begin to doubt that he's your hope that the struggle comes in your life. Optimism is just a psychological process in our life. It's based on the way you think. Hope is a theological process in our life. It is based on who God is and his relationship with you. See, if you get in and you read this word of God, and if you study it, it will give you a different perspective in your life. When you look at trials and tribulations, this will give you a theological way of looking at it, and you will see that there's not a problem that you will go through that hasn't been gone through already, and that Jesus Christ hasn't already provided the answer. He's given you a hope that is based on your ability to lift him up and to praise him and to exalt him. He wants to be lifted up. Optimism is positive thinking. A few years ago, I can remember when there was a positive thinking movement around the world. And if you could just positively think something, then it would be yours. I tried it a few times. I tried for that new Range Rover. I put a picture of it on my refrigerator, and every time I walked by, I was like, oh, thank you for my new Range Rover. And what I found out is that if I didn't have the courage to go and get it, it wasn't being dropped off on me, right? Thankfully, I didn't go get one, because I couldn't afford one. But I think about it, and I think all the positive hope that I have isn't going to do anything unless I have it with Jesus. Amen? Jesus has a way of changing our perspective. See, Jesus has a way of changing our heart's desire. You may think you want one thing, but when you get into the Word and you begin to experience the love of Jesus, he has a way of changing your desires. He has a way of making you at peace right where you are. Peter wrote to the Christians who had suffered persecution in Rome, in the Roman Empire. He said, one person we can have a radical hope is because God chose us before we chose him. Man, aren't you glad that your God was looking for you when you found him? Aren't you thrilled about the fact that he wanted you? I think sometimes about adoption. My wife and I, before we had our own children, we were really going to adopt children and not have our own children. Not because we couldn't, but because there was a lot of kids and we thought they needed homes. And so we've tried the adoption process. And you know, I admire people who adopt because they get to go pick that child. I got stuck with these two. No, just kidding. Just kidding. John's here. Jordan's over there. Just kidding. But think about it. Jesus come and he picked us. He picked us. He said, that's the one I want. I'm looking at that one and this is what I want. And so just imagine that. I've seen adoptive homes where that child is so loved and cared for and so excited that those people chose them to love them. I think it's so important for us to recognize we are a blessed people that Jesus Christ chose us from the beginning of time to know us and to want to give us hope today. He has a purpose in your life. He wants to make you holy for heaven. Understanding this simple truth can give you hope in your life. The highest honor you will ever receive is this: God invites you to spend eternity with him. God invites us to spend eternity with him. Get your thought around that today. It's kind of a big deal. Malachi used to say, it's a big deal. This is kind of a big deal. Jesus wants us to spend eternity with him. And it's why we can have hope, no matter what's going on in life, that Jesus is touched by what we're experiencing. You may feel lonely in your life. You say, well, Pastor, I got my family. I got my friends around me. I'm always with people. How could I be lonely? But when you get home at night and you're there, you feel empty and lonely inside. You can feel worthless. You can feel like that life isn't worth it. But I want you to know today that Jesus Christ has given you hope for today. He has lifted us up, and he is ready to provide hope in your life. You are never, ever alone. If you have asked Jesus Christ in your heart, you are never alone. Jesus is there with you. He loves you. He cares about you. And he wants to be your heavenly Father. Why do so many people struggle with hopelessness today? Because they are looking for an answer in science and everything else, but they have forgot to look at a theological answer in the Bible of Jesus Christ, where he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life, and every man that cometh to me, I will go to the Father for him, and I will make intercession for him. You see, we can have that hope today when we get into the theological understanding that Jesus chose us and then he sanctified us. He cleansed us. He made us whole. Aren't you glad for the convicting power of Jesus Christ that comes on our lives? And that convicting power of Jesus says, did you remember this? Make sure you ask forgiveness for that. Clean that out. Stop that. Don't do that. No more of that junk. And that convicting power moves in our life, and it perfects us and makes us holy so that the Father can, our Jesus Christ, the Son, can go to the Father and say, Lord, I have made intercession for them. They are loving you. They have asked forgiveness, and I see no sin in them. They are clear. That's what the Bible tells us. How are you passionately trusting God in your life? Are you living a life where you are believing and trusting him for everything that goes on? Are you putting your hope in the government? Are you putting your hope in those things around us? Are you putting your hope in the church? Are you putting your hope in a pastor? Are you putting your hope in your friends and your family? I hope not. I think all of those relationships are important, but there's only one that deserves the passion from your deepest heart place, and that is the relationship with Jesus Christ. He is the only one that is going to sustain you. All other things will pass away, and there will be you and Jesus. How does the truth of God has chosen you give you hope? I don't know about you, but I sometimes feel a little insecure. You know, I got up here this morning and I got stripes going this way and got stripes going this way. And I can get really insecure sometimes. And I feel like, oh, maybe I shouldn't have worn this. And maybe I feel like, okay, everybody's looking at me. Look at me. Everybody's looking at me, and I can I can feel insecure at times. But here's what I know. The fact that Jesus Christ came and said, I'll take that little ugly redheaded boy right there. I'll take the one who as a kid was shy and didn't want to be seen and certainly didn't want to be heard. He came and he said, I'll take that one right there. Man, that gives me some hope this morning. It gives me some security this morning that Jesus Christ said he would choose me. He has chosen you this morning. He loves you and he cares about you. Don't let this world lie to you and tell you that life is not worth living. Don't let any problem in your life come along and tell you that God is not the answer for you. Don't let anything rob you of the hope of the eternal life that Jesus has put within you. He loves you and he cares about you. This morning, in closing, I just ask you this question. Have you allowed Jesus to become first in your life? Nothing else will matter. Not one thing will matter. It won't matter how many parking lot services you attended, or how many services you came to church, or how many times you were in Sunday school. It won't matter how many years you've called yourself a Christian. It will not matter how long your name has been on the Sunday school roll in your church. The only thing that is going to matter is, do you have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ? If you have a personal relationship with Him, you can be assured that you will see Him for eternity. My Bible tells me that I'm longing for a time when Jesus will step forth and He will have them blow the trumpet, and that sky will open up and I will be pulled up from here. And I'll tell you, if it happens today, just look at the bottom of my feet, because I'm headed up. Amen. I'm changing my location for a destination in the sky. I'm going to have me some new shoes. I'm going to walk around in a shiny white robe. I'm going to be up there in heaven with my Lord. So I want to remind you this morning, you need the hope of Jesus Christ in your life. The Bible tells us that we can have that hope by just simply asking Jesus to come into your heart. There's those who are watching us on Facebook today. There's those that are here in the parking lot. Take just a moment and examine your life. Examine your life and see, am I living the way God wants me to live? Am I passionately serving Him today with all of my life and all of my heart? God wants to know today where you are, and He's asking you that question. Where are you? With your heads bowed, your eyes closed, in a reverence to our Lord, whether you're at home or you're here in the parking lot, I would ask you, are you serving Jesus to your fullest potential? Jesus wants to love you. His word says that we just have to ask Him to come into our heart. So today I'm going to ask you at home and here to all repeat this prayer after me. Dear Jesus, come into my heart. I need you. I want you to forgive me. I want you to cleanse me. I want to serve you all the days of my life. I want this hope that Pastor talks about. Jesus, I will serve you. I trust you. I believe you. In Jesus' name, amen. Everyone looking at me, I just want you to know that if you prayed that prayer today, Jesus Christ has come into your heart, and He's changed everything about you. It doesn't matter if you're wearing stripes, polka dots, or whatever you're wearing today. Jesus Christ loves you. He's not looking at our color coordination. He's looking at our heart right now. And if you meant what you prayed today, then Jesus has come into your heart. I pray that you would share that good news with someone around you. Tell them that you prayed that prayer. If you're on Facebook, you can put it in the little comment section. Send us a little text that tells us that you've accepted Jesus as your Lord and Savior today. We want to get back to you and make sure that we are sharing the gospel with you in every way that we can. So we encourage you to do that. We thank you for being a part of our church. If you have a church that you attend, we encourage you to go there. If they are preaching the Word of God to you, if they are going to the only book that really matters, and that's the Holy Scriptures of God, and theologically they are teaching you what the Scriptures tell you about your life and about the relationship with Jesus, go there. But if they are not, you can come here. There's many churches in our area that are preaching the Word of God. Go there. But make sure you go to church. They need you. Jesus needs you. And you need them. You need a relationship with people who will encourage you. And so I pray you do that today. As you leave today, I pray a blessing on your life. I'm going to give you just a couple seconds, and I'm going to make my way out to the end of the parking lot. Maddie's going to come back, and then her and Megan are going to sing a song as we close. But as I make my way back there, just a couple of instructions. If you're going to turn right onto 52, stay on this right side of the entrance. If you're turning left, stay to the left side of the entrance. And the right folks can go this way and get out, and the left folks can go this way and get out. And that way we won't cause too much of a traffic jam out there. And we just thank you for being here today. You guys are our heart, and we love each and every one of you. You make us so happy to see you, and we get so excited, and so we thank you for being here today. Join us every day at 12:30. I love you all. Join us at 12:30. Maddie's coming back to lead us in some worship, and just God bless you. I want God's richest blessing on all of your lives. I want Him to do great and mighty things in your hearts today. God bless.